evening and welcome to The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasanja. My guest tonight is none other than the Minister for Finance, Planning and Economic Development, Honorable Matia Kasaija. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Honorable, would you in your description still say the economy is still...
No, intervening factors have come through. So I can't now say, but at that time it was definitely moving like this. You all know what is taking place around the world. We all know what is taking place in the country. Certainly it will not be able to move at the speed at which we had been thinking about at that time.
Right, but maybe speaking in real terms, how are we performing right now?
Well, I haven't got the latest of statistics, but for sure, for merely looking at what is taking place, because production has gone down, apart from farming maybe, but industrial farming has gone, production has gone down, trade has been virtually, is almost a standstill. Trade between ourselves and between our neighboring countries has also come down. So I cannot quote, but we think by the end, if this were to end by around July, the economy our estimate figure now is about 3 to 4%, as against 6% projected.
Honorable, how can we, once we recover and are back up and running, how are you planning to organize the country to see to it that we regain or pick up from where the economy stopped?
Oh, well, there are a number of policy options which we intend to put into effect. One, we want to help our business community, and they have already asked that for that, for reliefs in terms of tax and other monthly expenses that they normally incur. So that's one policy option. You know, the Baganda have a saying that Omala kwe kona. Baganti ekira netonya. You people know the language better, you can fill in. For us, we are seeing golden opportunities in this problem. Hitherto, we have been too dependent on imports. If I told you the statistics here, we imported last financial year, 6.7 billion, almost 7 billion US dollars of imported products. Now we are saying no. We are going now, immediately things begin to stabilize, we should produce all that, at least half of those goods here in Uganda. And it's possible. We are making analysis. You wait, we'll tell you, when the analysis is completed, I will tell the country on the sector that we are going to emphasize to produce here so that we can substitute for those exports.
Honorable, when you say golden opportunities,
you
say golden opportunities, what exactly do you mean?
let me answer your question by asking a question. Do you want to continue being a supermarket of other people?
No. But do we have the capacity to produce and sustain ourselves?
Why don't you have the capacity? Why do you think the others have capacity, we don't have the capacity? What don't you have here? Look at your agricultural sector. What can't you produce in Uganda? What can't you produce? We can produce anything in Uganda, including temperate crops. You go to mountain in Rwenzori, you can grow apples. In Kabale, apples are growing. Even in Karamoja, I went to Karamoja, a certain parish, Catholic parish, I found them, they were growing grapes. So what can't we do in agriculture? That's one. Two, we have minerals here. This country is full of minerals. The only problem with minerals is a question of techno. We know where these minerals are, but the technology to dig them out, in some cases, we are lacking. Also, what we may be lacking is the money. Take your oil. That oil was discovered more than 10 years ago. We are still fumbling now, up to today, because we don't have the money to pull it out. Would have put that money, if we had money, would have put out that oil more than, say, maybe 5-10 years, more than 5 years from today. So, we have got people in the country who know what the business community, they are upbeat actually with this policy of what we call import substitution. I was with the private sector yesterday, and they say, Minister, now you are beginning to talk. And they are working tonight. They will come back here, you know, another week to come and tell me, Minister, this one, we are going to produce here locally. Let me ask you a question. Isn't it a shame that you go to some supermarkets here and we start buying oranges from some countries which are drier than ourselves? Have you ever thought about that?
I think that we have capacity to produce, but my question to you then would be, how come, for example, commercialization of agriculture is not emphatically reflected in your proposed budget for 2020?
Commercialization is not put forward. Are you ready? Have you read very well?
I have, but no. What I'm saying is that your priorities are in security. The lion's share has been given to security and infrastructure. Then we have education and health, but agriculture still, the same song that we've been singing for the last so many years.
Can I ask you a question? We talk about security. Without security, will you be able to do agriculture? Answer me. Without security, will you be... Well, I don't know how old you are in the... How old were you in 1986 when we took over power here?
I was not here.
This town, when we took over, I was here. By this time, nobody would be in town here. And you'll see poor with the girls and the women carrying their little bugugu, going back to Nakurabie, Namirembe, Natete. That was the situation here. You couldn't move even up to Jinja. It was impossible. Because at that time, that part of the country was being manned by the other armies. If you get there, you are lucky if you are not shot dead. So the question of security, please, that one never talk. It is the bedrock of everything that we do. So we must make sure that our country is secure. The army is looked after the best way we can. It is equipped properly. In case somebody wants to come and bring Matatizo here, we handle him or hand her appropriately. Just to, that's point number one. Let me clarify this question of agriculture financing. I have had this, I've explained, let me use this opportunity. This country men and country women, please listen to me carefully on this matter. Agriculture is a multi-sectoral supported sector. When I construct a road, I'm supporting agriculture. Let me give you a personal case. Two, I am a farmer, as you may know. I grew pineapples in a certain place in Kibale. And the pineapples did very well. When they were ripening, we got rains like we are now having rains. It reached a point 3 kilometers from the main road to the farm. It reached a point when you could not access the farm except by foot. No motorbike would go there. No, even a four-wheel drive, I think, because there is a river that had a broken bridge. Now, I lost 6,000 pineapples because of that 3 kilometers road not being accessible. I mean, in the farm not being accessible. So when I work on roads, I'm supporting agriculture. when I work on health, who is going to eat what you produce? I'm supporting agriculture. When I support, when I fund electricity, I'm supporting agriculture, because that electricity will be the one which will help you to add value. Are we getting very well? So, well, please, I want to remove this I hear Manyamputo, Maputo. Please, agriculture, we are financing it, both directly as power resource available, but also indirectly. So when you come and say you have put so little money in agriculture, I don't agree with you, because I've told you that these other sectors, for them, for agriculture to be able to tick, they must be in shape. Have I made this point very clear? Have you understood me?
I have understood you, Honorable, but still the question would be, you, like you rightly say, we are under lock and key because of the pandemic, and everyone would think that priorities would have been changed. For example, people expected that health would be taking probably priority in the previously passed budget, but it seems like still the issue is security, which whose budget has grown up to 4 trillion, but we are not going to fight, we are not going to war.
We are not going to fight, but you need to have an army that is ready in case. Anyway, I excuse you because you don't know security issues. You must prepare your army 24 hours. They must be ready. You never know an enemy can decide to come and attack here. What will you do? our security forces must be prepared to take it, to jump into action should anything happen. That is the best way to manage a country. If you neglect your security, then you have neglected everything. I can tell you that one. So let's not argue about why we have given more money to security. It's simply because security is the anchor of everything that you are doing. And they have their requirements they need. I have not even given them everything they want. Are you aware of the bulk of our army is still sleeping in Mama Ingiapoli? The bulk of our army, the majority, yes, they are still sleeping in Mama Ingiapoli. You know what Mama Ingiapoli?
Yes.
Hey! But I must make sure that they have food, they have got equipment, particularly, they are trained, we recruit. So that's why that figure goes where you are saying it is.
So, Honorable, how is the current budget, the recently passed budget, the 45 trillion budget, how is it going to respond to the current situation in terms of the pandemic?
The pandemic, well, if you listen to me when I was concluding my remarks on the budget in Parliament, because we are facing a future which is so uncertain, I cannot, what that budget was formulated, and I told the Parliament very openly, including Cabinet, that we have formulated this budget prior the pandemic, the COVID problem. Neither you nor anybody. I don't think anybody knows when this virus will disappear from the world. We don't know. But by law, I had to present a budget. Now, depending on how the situation evolves in the future, there may be some changes. There will be, very likely there will be changes, because in terms of revenues, in terms of expenditure, there may be change of expenditure, but a budget had to be in place according to the law. There is no way you can run a system without a plan. That plan, uncertain or as unfocused it may be, there must be a plan. So the current budget that was passed by Parliament of 45.5 trillion you are talking about is a budget that was prepared before COVID came to us. Now, because we don't know when COVID is going to end, if it ends quickly, but whatever time it will end, if it needs to revise the figures and the priorities, we shall do so. Then I will go back to Parliament.
But Honourable, there were voices in Parliament that probably there was a window for adjustment of a few things. For example, recurrent expenditure. You seem to be laid back on administrative costs. For example, salaries, bloated government, very many RDCs. Yesterday, we created new administrative units, yet you had previously said that government does not actually have the resources to fund new administrative units. Now, here we are, we have 15 new cities. Those cities, each one of them is going to probably have 2 to 3 MPs. We are going to have mayors in those cities, where yet the public would expect that right now, the focus should be on rebuilding the economy and fighting off the virus in the health sector, using the health sector, but that didn't seem to come out.
Well, you know, government is a very interesting machine, and for us who decide to live under democracy, even when you disagree with an idea, if it's supported by the majority, you let it pass. I have answered your question.
Honorable, you've not.
I have answered, please. I have said, let me repeat. When you are in a democracy, where the majority prevail, a decision can be passed and you disagree with it. But once it has been passed by the majority, you go along.
So should Ugandans have hope that you will be able to actually confront this challenge head on, or because the majority said even if they made a wrong decision, so God for us all, everyone for us?
No, if time comes and if there is need, absolute need, to revise the decision, we shall go back to Parliament and the Cabinet and get the decision reversed. You see, I cannot stand up here and say I disagree publicly. No. Once the decision has been taken by Cabinet and has been taken by Parliament, I go along. Some of us don't agree. We didn't think this was the time to pass Not that I am anti, please. Also, people should understand me. I'm saying, is it now a top priority? Must it come now? Couldn't it wait until in the future when things are stable? But some people said no, and they went ahead.
So how does really communication and decision making work in government? Because you're talking about a decision that is critical, that preceded another decision that is a question of controversy in the eyes of the public. That was the over 900 billion supplementary, on which Parliament deducted 10 billion for the parliamentary commission to disperse 20 million to each individual MP. And the view would be that you would take a position as Minister of Finance that we are going in the wrong direction. It doesn't really augur well that the whole Minister of Finance simply on matters economics and finance simply lets decision be taken the way the other people want to.
I don't attend all parliamentary sessions. I don't. Sure. And once a decision has been taken, although I disagree with it, my hands are tied. I cannot stand on my two legs and say, no, you are wrong. The best thing I can do is maybe to go back to Parliament quietly and say, can we go and revise this decision? Now, that will depend on the Speaker, and we depend on the majority of members of Parliament. I can't, there's no way I can do that. Otherwise, then you run in trouble. You will divide the government. There are certain things, you know, as you grow old, there are what we call wisdom. There is what we call wisdom. Is it wise as a minister to stand up and oppose a decision that was taken by cabinet? Then you might as well say, I have resigned. That's the only other solution you can, if you want to become populist. Because by resigning also, you will not do what? You will not change the status quo. You can, people will see you as a hero, whatnot, but we call that populism. The real issue is to go back quietly and discuss and see if your point of view will be shared. If it's not shared, then you leave it.
Honorable, I would still insist to ask why is it that health was not made
a priority?
Not a priority, but didn't take the lion's share of the budget.
Oh, we have. No. Get your figures properly. I don't have my figures here. I would have shown you. No, health got very, very big money, for sure. You have the budget? They are now taking what percentage? Is it 5 or something like that? I wish you had gotten me earlier on. I could have got my figures.
5%, but below security, infrastructure, yeah. Works and transport, education.
Yeah. Now, again, I go back. You will not have security. You will not have health when you don't have security. You will not. You will not have health when you have no roads. How? You tell me. A patient, listen, no. You see, I think countrymen and countrywomen, let's understand very clear on this. How will you have health when a patient cannot be moved from point A to point B to hospital because there is no road? Is that health? Just like I said for agriculture. How will you have agriculture when you cannot move goods from point A to point B? What the use? You can produce and then throw away the produce. So roads, railways, airports are very, very crucial as we speak now. Unless you have that infrastructure, for example, even electricity. You cannot talk about industry without electricity. And yet, industries are the ones which will help you to be able to boost your economy. So if I put more money in, if you had been saying, you have been running this show, Mr. Minister, for 20 years, you have been putting money in electricity, you have been putting money in roads, you've been putting money in defense, always over and above the others. The only other expression would be maybe those sectors are still undeveloped and you want to get them to a certain level. But if you have brought them to a certain second level, then you shift now emphasis. I've been having a big argument with some development partners who think and argue the way you are arguing. You are not putting enough money in education. You are not putting money in health. You are making roads. Who are you making those roads for? Good argument. But I'm saying these roads are necessary. This electricity is necessary. The railway is necessary for the economy to be able to kick start and start moving. Then you will be able to generate revenue to sustainably, take back my word, to sustainably fund the social sectors. So it's a question of balancing. You have to do a bit of balancing. We don't neglect it completely. No. We don't neglect it completely. Yeah. We don't neglect it. And we have not neglected health. We have not neglected education. No. We have put a certain amount of money which we think will help them to move on. They may not move on in a perfect form. They would have wanted more money. As I build my capacity to run the economy, as I build the capacity for the economy to grow, to expand. And then you generate revenue, then you can build all the schools you want, you can build all the hospitals you want, you can bring all the equipment you want. But without an economy that is growing, without an economy that has got anchor, there are about three or four things that are a bottleneck in Uganda now for business. First one is roads and railways. Roads and railways. Those we President Museveni call them cost pushers. Roads, transport. Let's put the word transport. Two, electricity. We are supplying electricity here most expensively. 8 cents, 10 cents. Which investor will come and spend 8 cents, 10 cents, 15 cents to produce? They will not, because it becomes uncompetitive. The third cost pusher is the cost of money. People who want to go borrow money, they go. I get amazed, but without giving a solution. How do you borrow money at 20% and you're going to put it in a factory and you think you'll get that money out? That's why we are struggling now to put money in UDB so that UDB can be able to lend to these people at an interest rate not more than 20%. So, you need to balance, in order to conclude this matter, you need to balance between the productive and supporting sectors to help you make the economy grow bigger. When it grows bigger, then you'll get more tax revenues. Then when you have got more tax revenues, then you can now go and take care of the social services. Other than, you will continue borrowing. Continuing borrowing is also dangerous, because you are going to put your economy in a very difficult situation where you will fail to pay back the loans and the interest. So we, as I said, you have to do some balancing act.
Honorable, maybe for the benefit of the viewer, you would articulately help them educate on what informs the basis for allocation, for budget allocation.
Oh, I see. Government, every year we lay down what we call priorities. Every year, we say the priority, others are repeated, like the roads, I'm telling you, the roads are repeated. Even now, let me tell the roads. We discovered oil. Now you have reminded me. In order to get that oil out, we need a pipeline and we need a refinery. Now, the pipeline, according to the oil companies, is passing to, they made a measure, and the roads alone must be tarmacked. Otherwise, there is no way they are going to carry the pipes and all the equipment when there is no road. So that now becomes a, if we want to pour out that oil, that becomes a priority. There is the refinery which we want to put up. For the refinery, there are certain equipment that must be brought to a place called Kabale. There must be an airport. Because some of them, you can't come and drop them in Entebbe and be able to carry them on a truck to take them where? To take them to a place called Kabale, in Hoima. So that means the airport must be constructed. So you see the logic? Hey, this is the logic. There are certain things you must do them in order for you to get to jump and go ahead. If you don't do that one, you'll be running the economy in the reverse, and it will not be very nice for the future.
Welcome back from that break. Honorable, you seldom go to Parliament to ask for supplementary budgets, which seems to be a norm, yet we have a normal budgeting process. Should we say this is a question of not being prudent in planning for the country?
Ordinarily, I'll answer that question. Ordinarily, a supplementary should be something that one could not have foreseen. Something like, I could never have foreseen this coronavirus. Nobody could have foreseen it. That's why I had to go to seek for a supplementary. The other one is unavoidable. Like, for example, again, it is touching and foreseen. Our people now, the lake is rising. The level is rising. And our people on the islands, they are under big threat. We have to make arrangement to evacuate them. There comes a situation where if you do not do A, then B will come. And as such, B is an adverse either event or it will cause more harm than by if you do not take action. There is also activity that which are time bound, but people did not see them. Did not see them at the time when we were budgeting. What am I saying? Supplementaries should be prepared for things either which you could not foresee, or which is unavoidable, or which are time bound, but somebody did not see them in that light. There is also a little bit of indiscipline, if I may say. People not wanting to live within the means that are available. That's another problem, unavailable. That's why you see these supplementaries coming. In a country like ours, you will decide that there are many things that will happen which you didn't foresee. There are many things that will spring up that you couldn't avoid. And there will be many things, certain things, not many, there will be things that which are time bound, that if you don't do it this now, then the consequences are this. And the consequences are not nice. That's why you see these supplementaries coming. Good enough it is providing the law. It is providing the law on how the supplementary should be treated. The indiscipline, because you see, somebody forgets to do his job or her job, and the thing then springs up, which is time bound. You hear that? It is time bound. Now, not to embarrass the government or to get our people in a difficult situation, then you raise a supplementary. I don't like them, I can tell you that one. But the problem also is resources. At the time of budgeting, because I can tell you some of the supplementaries, they would be more or less foreseen, because someone comes and gives you a budget, says, I want 10 billion for this. You give him only 8 to remain. You knew very well that he wanted 10, and he has just fight. But because of your limited resources, you give him 8. So, by good chance, something may now save in the course of the running of the financial year. You either get some savings somewhere, or you get a good Samaritan, it happens, he gives us a grant. Now, the only way you can fill that gap of 2 billion is to get to go supplementary. Because there is no way, according to our law, there is no way you can give money to any entity without the money having been what? Being appropriated. That's the law. So that's one of the reasons that takes us to Parliament to seek supplementaries.
Honorable, by December 2019, we had made a revenue shortfall of about 600 billion. But revenue collection continues to be a challenge, even in this current budget. You pointed out that because of some of the challenges that we are facing generally as a country, we might not realize revenue as we had anticipated. But one would then ask, for example, we as a country export minerals, but there are certain things, for example, gold, there are certain things that are never reflected in revenue collection. What are you doing to ensure that these other natural endowments that the country has generate more revenue for the country, other than simply depending on just me, the taxpayer, because I work and...
But you see, to in order for these minerals to give you money, you must have capital to extract them. You have to have capital. You need it to borrow again money. Either now I go to borrow, or if I don't borrow, then I suppress another sector. There is no way you are going to get these minerals and turn them into wealth without having money. It is as simple as that.
How are you planning for the country to utilize money from oil?
Oh, from oil? Oh, money from oil is well taken care of from the legal point of view. We have got the oil laws. That may be another time I could come with the oil experts, they will tell you. But there are rules and regulations, there are reserve accounts. Money from oil can only be spent on certain items of or sectors. It's really tight. It is not money that you can flash around like that, because you collide with the law. If you want another time, we could come. As I said, I can bring my experts in law. They will tell you all these provisions, the funds that we are supposed to keep money in. They are all those are available within the law. So me, I'm fully confident that oil money. To be really, I cannot see somebody really who can play with that money, unless he wants to go to jail or something like that.
In the budget, you projected that about 27.5% of the budget funding will come from will be external funding. But you are aware that most world economies are on their knees because of the coronavirus. Doesn't this put you in a tight situation in terms of actualizing the budget?
No, because external, I'm not talking about donations. When we talk about external, it means either you are going to get a grant from some multilateral institutions like World Bank, like the African Development Bank, or you will borrow. So that's not a problem, because that one is not so much. In fact, we are getting good offers already now. We are getting good offers. From the World Bank, from IMF. You saw me here sign a letter. IMF have agreed to lend us almost $500 million in order to recapitalize UDB and also to pay our obligation to Bank of Uganda. And there are many other which are coming. Many offers are coming. But we have to weigh them, because some are grants, but some are loans.
Honorable Kasaija, oil prices across the world are dwindling. And as Uganda, we had hinged all our hopes
on oil.
Oil production. How? What's your assessment of the impact, and how can we get out of this situation?
First of all, you know, I'm an oil man. I worked for the oil company for 7 years. From time immemorial, the prices of oil have always been like this. So, to me, I'm not frightened. I'm not discouraged. They will fall, but they will shoot up again. So, what one needs to do strategically is how do you regulate your production in accordance with the movements of the price. That's all.
economists are predicting a very bleak post-COVID-19. As the Minister for Finance, do you have any plans? And in predicting a bleak post-COVID-19, they are talking of job cuts, companies winding up. Do you have, as Minister for Finance, do you have any plans of bailing out
Uganda?
Ugandans to ensure that you resuscitate the economy?
First of all, I think people don't know their history. People don't know their history. Yes, in the short run, there will be a downside. But as soon as, I want to assure you, as soon as we have defeated this enemy, I can tell you people will swing in action. In fact, me, I have a feeling there's going to be a lot of production. It's going to be a lot of production. Because first of all, some people have been starved of certain things. Now, there will be that demand. The only issue, of course, is how do you put money in the hands for people to have what we call disposable income. That's the only shortfall. But me, I have a belief, and I can tell you, even here in Uganda, people are going to, once this thing is finished, people are going to produce quite massively to meet that hunger of things that actually people missed out. This is what happened about after the Second World War. Production just shot up like this. That's what happened. So, me, my fellow Ugandans, let's just prepare ourselves. Once this enemy has been totally eliminated, then you have asked me what plans. I don't want to preempt it. I will be coming up with a statement in Parliament in a couple of days to show you what we think in the government we should focus on and how we should get there. Okay, that way we shall get there. But meantime, my prayer is that everybody should be now preparing himself or herself to ensure that we engage ourselves in economic activities that are producing wealth. My fellow farmers, let's prepare ourselves. There is going to be a lot of demand for food. The industrialists, please start preparing yourselves to expand your factories because there will be demand of your own goods and so forth. Now, the only challenge which I still see is how to quickly put money in the hands of the citizens so that there is what we call effective demand. But if the producers increase their volumes, then they will be taking on either the old workers or they will be taking on the new workers. The only problem I also can see is the saturating our own market. You know, now Uganda is a surplus country, and over time we were being in surplus. We have more milk than we are consuming. We have more sugar than we are consuming. We have got maize, which is more we produce than we can consume. My prayer then would be that first of all the East African community should form part of our market. And then, of course, the international market. That's the only problem that I see, which is a bit, which is hazy. The market that would uplift these things at a competitive price. That's why I see the problem, a slight problem. But once that one is overcome, we shall campaign, of course, we shall go and with our East African community, brothers and sisters, we shall go into the world to search for a market. And the Minister for Industry is definitely doing that. He's searching now.
Honorable, as government, are you prepared for the baby boom? Because we are under lock and key, and you are aware that Ugandans are very funny. Are you planning for this?
You know, I have loved. Well, Uganda is, first of all, me as an old man, you should plan. It is not because you have a lot of time with your partner. Because if you also produce those children, when you have not planned for them, you are going to have a problem on your hands. So my appeal to you, don't lose guard. There are many ways these days, medical ways and mechanical ways you can avoid pregnancy, definitely. So, but if the Ugandans produce them, then I have no choice but to look after them.
Thank you very much.
I look after them.
Thank you very much, Honorable Matias.
Thank you.
Talking to the Minister for Finance, Planning and Economic Development on the prospects of leaping forward in terms of economic and finance planning in the wake of the novel coronavirus.
You want to give me a chance to give my closing remarks?
Sure.
First of all, let me thank you people for having come to give me an opportunity to converse with my fellow Ugandans on this issue of the economy. I want to assure every Ugandan, even our neighbors, that we are more determined than ever to make sure that this economy is strengthened. To me, this is what has happened is like a shock. No, not a shock. You know, when you are moving on a journey, you may find a roadblock and you hold on. To me, this was a mere roadblock. And we shall walk over that roadblock. I can tell you that one. And when we walk over that roadblock, we shall run faster. Because I want to go back to my... As long as I'm still the Minister of Finance here, I want to get back, because I had my vision of where I wanted to take this economy, and I've not lost that vision. We wanted to eliminate poverty from our people. In fact, when you go, we are going here into a session of how to eliminate poverty among Ugandans. There is no any explainable reason why Ugandans we should be poor. There is nothing. God gave this country everything that a human being would want. I have said this one when I was at the beginning. We can do anything in agriculture. We have resources. In fact, somebody was telling me the other day, he says, Minister, we see you struggling to get oil. If you concentrated on two or three minerals, you would get all the money that you want to get. That man is an expert on these issues. So we have minerals in this country. Tourism, what don't we have? Weather, you are seeing, is a big asset. Many people in the temperate parts of the world would want to come and enjoy this weather because they don't have. Those of you who know, now the southern hemisphere, now they are going through their winter. Yes, down south, they are now very cold. Up north, they are getting hot. To such an extent that everybody, you feel like walking naked. You have seen these Europeans on their beaches almost going half naked because the weather is extremely hot. But here, temperatures varying from 18 to 28. This is the temperature that which everybody would want to live in. So, we definitely don't lose hope. Don't spend sleepless nights that the economy is gone. No, it is not going at all. If anything, now we should prepare ourselves to see this economy moving and everybody taking action, taking part. Everybody, this thing has taught us a lesson. For us in the cabinet, in the government, we now are positioning ourselves sooner than later. As I said, I will be coming to tell the world, the country, of how we want to have as many things produced in this country as possible. Because kisoboka. And I'm glad, by the way, I don't know whether you know that. Even now, in this confusion of COVID, many people are beginning to produce things. Are you aware that now we are producing more of these sanitizers down here? I mean, in the country? And people are already beginning to export it. So we should look for opportunity. In my life philosophy, for anything that happens to me, the Europeans say, the Englishmen say that for every black cloud, there is a To me, I look for opportunity. And my professor who taught me in the 60s in university, let me share this one as an old man. He taught me one thing and I have gone with it throughout my life. He says, he was telling us, young man, he was an American, young man, learn how to turn a disadvantage into an advantage. For us in government now, we are going to turn this problem, which is devastating many people, into an advantage. You wait for me, I will tell you how we are going to turn this this problem we are having now into an advantage. For the economy to grow much faster, more dependent, more integrated, and so forth.
Once again, we don't take it for granted that the Honorable Matia Kasaija, the Minister for Finance, Planning and Economic Development, has spared time to speak to us. Be sure to catch Checkpoint tomorrow, 9:30, right here.